Tantor Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents An Equation with One Unknown by Vasily Mahanenko. Translated by Colin Parker. Narrated by B.J. Harrison. Chapter 1. If you have a cool plan but have not considered the risks, you may remove your pants with confidence and use your plan for its true purpose. Although even here, there are options. Wipe or insert. It's up to the individual. But one thing is for sure. The plan will not succeed. I'm telling you this in my capacity as a former project manager. In which case, let Operation Rip 'em to Shreds begin. The province of Lokdar will be ours. Eradani ran his finger all businesslike down the list of clan ratings, hovering momentarily over several competitors. I was observing closely and remembering, when suddenly from the street came the invocatory shouts of a guardian. "Demons in the city! The western wall has fallen! Action stations!" The registrar froze like a Madame Tussaud's creation, mid-conversation with a client, and we received a notification.
Location scene, defense of Lokdar. Description: demons, levels 40 to 80, have penetrated the western wall and swept into the city. Understand who you are, a hero or a coward. Do you take on all comers, or do you hide in your holes? Remaining demons, 220. Time to end of scene, 2 hours, 30 minutes. Rewards will be issued in accordance with contribution to defense.
General chat. Vardunas.
All players in the location. I am the leader of the clan Ruward. This is our location. Touch even one demon, and you sign up for rebirth.
Everyone's so cocky. My partner didn't let me finish, dragging me quickly outside and sprinting off.
Where are we going? To fight?
To fight, he echoed in reply.
I could barely keep up with Eradani. He moved swiftly, as though he knew the city inside and out. We had to dodge oncoming players and NPC guardians. After accidentally elbowing a bewhiskered warrior and receiving a contemptuous look in return, I realized that unlike most, we were running away from the point of penetration.
Eradani?
I looked around, lost. Where are we going? He heard me, but didn't stop or slow down.
Eradani. Why are you stopping? We have to find shelter.
Kvalen.
What for? Everyone's running to fight.
No answer. Something crashed and clanged above us, and I involuntarily started after the tiefling. I caught up to him by a dilapidated building enveloped in scaffolding, and only then because he'd stopped.
This is your genius plan? Scamper around like rats for the whole game?
Yes, but live rats. Get a move on.
Not waiting for a reply, he pulled me towards the rickety entrance to the building. His behavior confused me. No sooner had he pulled me backward into the darkness, his hand over my mouth, than I heard someone land heavily on the cobblestones. Dust scattered down. Eradani let me go with a quiet shh. We held our breath and froze.
I can feel you.
An evil whisper. The tips of my horns and tail began to itch excruciatingly, like my crotch in real life whenever I sensed danger.
Go, go, go,
Eradani whispered, and tore into the depths of the building, shoveling building rubble aside with his hands.
There's a basement. Half-bloods, I can smell your fear. The Overlord will be pleased.
Curiosity is no sin, but its punishment is painful, as I discovered when I lingered to look back at the door. Two wooden objects, my forehead and a ceiling beam, clashed almightily, resulting in tangible losses. The beam was sizably dented,
and I lost a hard-hitting 100 HP. But I did get a look at our pursuer. Nothing special. Only a massive steroid demon with a boss pictogram and laser pointers for eyes. His level 80 was enough for me to switch into warp speed and hightail it after my partner. By now, I was in full support of Eradani's tactic. Run. Run like the wind. Run like you've never run before. Attacking such a beast at our level was akin to giving ourselves up as sacrificial lambs.
Pray.
I couldn't see, but I could feel the demon's snout beaming with the thrill of the chase. I hadn't managed to avoid his laser eyesights.
Debuff received. Stun. You are immobilized for 30 seconds.
Despite the description, I still had some control over my body. Heavily, and scrabbling for each centimeter, I was moving. The training camp sessions swam up in my consciousness. There was just me and the route to the basement. No falling girders, clattering sounds, or distant shouts from the resistance. Just me and the passageway. By chance, I heard the boss successfully negotiate the narrow entrance, demolishing the scaffolding in the process. Somewhere in another universe, Eradani was yelling. The dark basement doorway was enticing and seemed a safe oasis in all the bedlam. Of course, this was self-deluding, and the demon would easily get through. But it was best not to think about that. Suddenly, a large wooden chandelier flew down from the ceiling, describing an arc on its supporting rope before disappearing behind me. I hoped it would at least hinder the demon, if not stop him. Bam! My peripheral vision caught shards from the once fine light fixture. It didn't stop the demon. The heavy breathing drew nearer. The back of my neck broke out in goosebumps. Damn, damn, damn!
You are mine.
My chest tightened. What could be worse than feeling the hot breath of an incubus on your back? My eyes began in absolute seriousness to search for the exit button. You'll never take me alive. But the button kept mysteriously slipping out of focus. WTF! I couldn't concentrate, either because of the stun or because I was panicking. Suddenly, Eradani shot off ahead, seizing my hand and pulling me after him as best he could. The boss's taloned paw only managed to graze my clothes. After that, I remember a kaleidoscope of hard stone steps, the last of which triggered a supernova flare in my conscious, and everything began to fade. Somewhere in the distance, a terrible ruckus sounded. Dust drifted down, and I sailed off into a blessed darkness known as blackout, a one-minute debuff.
Come on, you filthy rat! Open your eyes!
Something vile was being poured into my mouth. I regained consciousness slowly, allowing myself to feel the difference between the process in reality and here. I'd had concussion once before, and was off sick for 2 weeks. My wife spoon-fed me healthy soup, tucked in my bedsheets, and flicked back and forth between Sport 1 and Muzz TV, because it was hard for me to even wiggle the toes of my right foot. In Barliona, everything was sorted with a flask of healing potion, and your body was instantly ready for new feats.
"Are we in a basement? Where is it?"
I asked, wiping my eyes. The race abilities of fire tieflings provided nothing of use in the dark. A thick pall obscured the view, scarcely revealing the outlines of objects. It was just enough to move forward, but sightseeing was out of the question.
"Where else?"
Eradani replied to my first question and sent me a link to a map of the location. In lieu of an answer to the second question, I heard dull thumps and a wrathful snarl from above. The doorway was securely blocked, and the incubus was searching for a way to get to us. "What the hell's it latched onto us for?" I wondered, opening the map. The part of the basement we were in was an extended corridor with a stairway going up at one end
and a foggy patch at the other. The image was 2D and primitive, with different colored triangles representing us, but it was now easier to navigate.
"Have you not read tales about dragons?" asked my partner for some reason.
"I have."
"Well, this incubus, like those dragons, only likes good-looking but stupid virgins," sniggered Eradani, hinting at the inexpedient inquisitiveness which had nearly got me nabbed by the incubus.
"Old experienced perverts, too," I said.
"And in actual fact, Kvalen, it's chasing us because we're tieflings."
Scene update. Defense of Lokdar. 219 demons destroyed. Vardunas.
"Guys, has anyone seen the boss? 1,000 gold for any info."
"The Ruard lads are sharp," came Eridani's voice through the haze. "Enough lying around. It won't take the boss a minute to pick that pile of rocks apart."
"Let's write to Vardunas that the boss is here," I suggested.
1,000 gold and riddance of the demon struck me as an excellent conclusion to a game session.
"Absolutely not. We must categorically not show our faces. Until our castle is level 3, better even level 5, we lay low, out of sight of the other clans,"
said Eradani too quickly and too vehemently. Intuition told me he was hiding his true motives.
"If anything happens, we kill ourselves. Let's go and see what lies ahead."
Ahead were silence and murk. Unable to trust my vision, I felt the walls. Nothing. No furniture, no crates, no random garbage. Just cold, bare stone. Eradani made his way along the adjoining wall, and the map automatically added the contours of the room. Wall, corner, wall. Doorway. Spiral staircase leading down.
A crash confirmed my partner's suspicions about the boss's abilities. It was making its way through the rocky barrier very quickly.
I began to doubt it was after us because of our race.
Down!
The blue triangle set foot on the staircase first, updating the map as it went and adding the second level. My hands on the wall to be safe, I followed him warily. Fortune, or the system, rewarded my caution as my splayed fingers almost immediately stumbled upon a cold shaft. Probing the object fleetingly, I recognized it as a torch. Obviously, my inventory contained no tinderbox or matches, but I took the torch with me anyway.
"Quake, traitors, I'm coming for you. I smell your sweet fear."
The snarl heralded the boss's breakthrough to the first level of the basement. I was concerned what the brute's night vision was like. Worse than ours would be all right with me. The stairway was strewn with rocks, significantly frustrating our descent. In places, the passageway was so narrow I could hardly squeeze through. If the boss could make it, nothing would stop it. Sure enough, I got stuck. Unlike the scrawny Eradani, my character had a healthy, fleshed-out physique.
"Give me your hand."
He tried to haul me through.
"No. Go into settings and remove your breastplate. It's getting in the way."
"Close. I smell traitors."
Our relentless pursuer was already at the stairs.
Bam!
The building shuddered. Stones and dust showered my back. The demon was digging a new entrance, made to measure for its size.
"Go, go, go!"
Progress was much easier without the breastplate, and the passageway became wider anyway. Eradani ran ahead, occasionally glancing back. At some point he activated a deceleration scroll and lobbed it deftly behind me. I followed its flight with my eyes, and seeing the results, automatically activated retreat. The demon's head appeared in the new hole, and the scroll smacked it right on the forehead, guaranteeing to slow it down by 50%.
Down!
Another stairway. I followed my partner, confused as to why we were going stubbornly deeper when it would have been so much simpler to die upstairs next to a guardian.
On the third level, it became clear this was the end. Eradani stood in the middle of a wide corridor, his torch held high. I had to shield my eyes from the blinding light. But I'd seen what there was to see. A dead end. Unable to believe our bad luck, Eradani lit my torch and gestured for me to inspect the walls. We took one each, thoroughly examining the blackened plaster work, and met back at the stairs.
"Hui," said Eradani.
Had I been asked to describe his condition, I would have said he'd got 5 balls out of 6 in the lottery, crashing and burning at the last. I imagined, real as life, Fortuna slowly drawing 5 balls, each time lingering to prolong the intrigue, and throwing the 6th ball down on the table without really looking at it, before breaking out in triumphant laughter. "No bingo, dipshits."
"I was mistaken, Kvalen. There are no..."
What there were none of, I didn't find out. The boss broke through to our level, showering us with dust and pebbles. We squashed ourselves virtually flat against the opposite wall.
"The hunger for the chase spurs me. You are mine."
Claws extended toward us, eager to embrace us before death, or whatever he wanted from us. This time I found the exit button straight away, but I knew I wouldn't press it. If I left, Kvalen's body would remain in danger, along with my partner. His level 14 was no match for 80, and scrolls wouldn't help here. Unless Aluna herself should deign all of a sudden to descend to this nether world to assist the outcasts.
Oh, yes, Aluna.
There was no time to think. It was now or never. First, I knocked Eradani out with an accurately placed hoof. He knew nothing about it, flying to the side, sliding down the wall, and slumping to the floor, while I ran ahead, directly into the incubus's embrace. The boss's paws closed in, and a symphony of emotions struck up in my chest. Hatred, precipitously replaced by bitterness, then agitation, tenderness, and a bunch more uncharacteristic feelings besides. In real life, I was sparing with my emotions, so I understood the clear distinction between the tiefling Kvalen, nestling in the paws of a love demon, and Brody West, lying in capsule number, whatever. "Gotcha, red face," I growled, hugging the demon back. I required a second to disorient it, which I got and used to shove my burning torch right into his laser eye. What a fortuitous piece of loot. The boss snorted, more from surprise than from the impact or pain, and while it was shaking its head, I snatched a ring from my inventory and put it on one of the boss's horns. Now it was bingo. A pity there was no full-blown celebration. I had just 50% from the demon, and disagreeable sensations were only switched on to 10%, but the large platinum ring of Aluna put a serious dent in that, twisting each nerve and relieving me of my mind. I wanted to die sooner to be done with it all.
"You have claimed an unnamed incubus. Subjugate its will, enslave, and name it. The demon will become your eternal slave, capable of fulfilling its master's fantasies."
I didn't fully understand the message at first, but I got the gist. Incubus, slave, fantasies. No big deal. The ring's action radius was so wide, it even caught Eradani, who lay whimpering and hunched in a fetal position by the wall I'd kicked him against. The boss was in a far sorrier state, dropping me, grabbing its head, and howling as it tried to pull out its horn. It couldn't touch the light object. A bouquet of debuffs riveted me to the floor, forcing me to lie there and behold the agony of the enemy. Utterly berserk, the demon charged and battered its head against the blind wall. The building shook, earthquake style, before the incubus began to thrash about along the corridor, clattering now into one wall, now into the other. I contemplated our situation with a sinking feeling. It remained to wait for the boss to kill himself before we could retrieve the ring, if the Ruards didn't get to us first.
Hi, horn boys.
The ringing female voice silenced even the incubus. Three silver lightning flashes, and the boss ceased its thrashing and collapsed on the floor beside me. The proximity of the ring made everything even hazier. Realizing I would not survive the prolonged agony, I reached out to the boss's horns. I felt a stabbing pain in my heart, and my consciousness muddied for a second, but I managed to swipe the ring and shove it back into my inventory.
The will of the unnamed level 80 incubus has been suppressed. Destroy the boss and gain its essence for later embodiment.
Sapped of strength, I closed my eyes and let my head flop to the floor. Something cold brushed my cheek. Opening one eye a crack, I saw boots made of thin leather. I could muster just enough strength to study them. They were beautiful and stylish and well made. I always had a weakness for fine leather footwear. It would be a shame if the wearer of these boots was not worthy of them.
Do you like them?
I winked an affirmative reply.
Me too. Have a look from this angle.
With a chuckle, the girl turned her foot, and my eye was presented with a masterfully fashioned and wetted heel. In response to the unambiguous threat, I found the strength to roll over onto my back, out of the line of attack, and let my gaze wander slowly over the lady's figure.
Had a good eyeful?
The owner of a marvelous bust asked, before jerking me to my feet and cutting short my detailed inspection of the sights. The view from above wasn't half bad either. Her eyes were two pieces of heaven, sent down to the sinful earth at the behest of the gods to aid a level 243 huntress. I would not have called Varmilda beautiful, but there was something about her. Her sharp, even mildly coarse features repelled and attracted in equal measure, forcing me to study each square centimeter of her face. I cannot say she was to my taste, but I certainly wasn't averse to consorting with her for a while. Madam, I bowed my head in greeting and flicked my tail, acknowledging her part in my deliverance from the incubus.
What are you doing here?
Intoned the siren unctuously, batting her eyes. Part of me wanted to recount my completion of the training camp, exile, creation of a clan, and evasion of a demon. But the other, much smaller part, Brody West, resisted. It didn't understand why Kvalen wanted to open up to the first girl he met, even if she was interesting. When the irrational intervened, the Brody in me eased the Kvalen aside, and I mumbled, playing with incubus. Basically, Ruard bagged themselves a boss, and you showed up. Thunderclouds obscured her heavenly eyes. My desire to confide disappeared in a clash, and clarity of thought returned. I shook my head to chase away the remains of the illusion, and regarded the huntress with my own eyes. Asian-looking, an excessive attachment to spiky objects, craggy facial features. The attraction soon fizzled out. Nothing special. I'd seen better. Eradani. Kvalen, plus one to respect. She used siren's pollen to win your favor, a banned substance. If the guardians find out, she'll be imprisoned. Don't look at me. Distract her. The information was most timely, and everything became crystal clear. The huntress shrugged, took a silver arrow from her quiver, and loaded it into the drawn horn bow that materialized in her hands.
That's their problem.
A fourth silver lightning bolt flashed, and the location closed.
Scene completed. Defense of Lokdar. See Deputy Governor for issue of rewards. Upgrades gained. Experience, +8 until next level, 80. Reputation with Light of Barliona faction increased by 3. You received the essence of a nameless incubus. This object is not bound to any player and may be transferred or sold.
I was delighted with this last message. Somehow I would fulfill my fantasies without the incubus. It needed selling or giving to someone soon. Maybe Varmilda? Oh yes, speaking of gifts, the archeress had destroyed the boss, so there was no reward for that. The experience was for the scene. 5 basic points, 1 for the pod, and a couple for charisma. I urgently needed to shell out for experience gems, then level up intensely and for a long time. Everything looked distinctly woeful without the training camp coefficient. The girl approached the incubus and grumbled.
Filth. Boss my ass. Not worth the arrows.
General chat. Vardunas.
Which bastard felled the boss?
Maybe you're not looking in the right place, I snickered. Maybe it is the reward. Do you need it?
Varmilda rolled her eyes.
General chat. Varmilda.
It was Kvalen and Eradani. I'm a witness. Old workshop, basement, level 3.
You... I couldn't even find the words. The Ruards would now come running, snuff us out, and deal with it.
Or maybe they wouldn't, and this critter would go into hiding.
General chat. Kvalen.
She's lying. It was she who killed the boss. I can prove it.
Varmilda laughed sonorously. Take care, horn boys.
With these words, the character dissolved into the air, and the player became invisible. Unfortunately, the boss disappeared along with Varmilda, denying us even the smallest reward for our trouble.
Kvalen, help! We've got 1 minute, Eradani shouted.
While I'd been dealing with the huntress, my partner had reached the place where the boss collided with the wall and begun to dismantle it, loosening the stones with his pickaxe. A twinkle of silver. I joined him, helping liberate a smooth metal door from under the stonework covering.
What is it?
Varmilda's voice rang out. Our ticket to freedom, mumbled Eradani.
The archeress materialized nearby and set about groping the metal plate for signs of a handle, a hole, anything.
She found nothing.
But her movements were very feminine, and instead of being indignant, I imagined myself in place of the door, her fingers boldly following the relief and stopping enthusiastically at, now then, Brody West, 238,682 multiplied by 333 equals...
You have successfully resisted Siren's pollen for a second time in 10 minutes. You gain immunity to the powder for 24 hours.
Varmilda shrugged once more and went invisible. My joy at the message was interrupted by a shout from Eradani.
There's a hireling from the Crane's group. It's a setup, so they can get to the treasure.
If the archeress even reacted to the allegations concerning these cranes, I wasn't meant to know about it. She reappeared as a petrified doll, accompanied by 2 pointy-eared bandits, Garleem and Shamble, levels 187 and 226, respectively. The emblem of the Ruard Guard stood out proudly by their names.
A setup, you say? Said Garleem, playing with some daggers. Perhaps it was you who wanted to set her up. What's that door? Who are the cranes?
Eradani was silent. We stood and watched Vardunas appear. The head of the clan squeezed through the door and began barking orders.
Bind Varmilda and take her to the deputy governor. Let her sit a while in jail. We'll interrogate her there. Take the tieflings to the castle. I wonder how they knew about the cash. Crack the door and take the treasure. Jump to it!
Vardunas played for the shaman, but for the chief of a location's top guild, his level was an inadmissibly low 33.
Were it not for the demon hacking its way through the rock, the broad-shouldered dwarf might never have gotten through to us. Dressed simply, not for raiding, old tambourine. A poor relation of sorts, given his own clan's warriors. But all that meant nothing when your eyes met his. I was fully aware what category of alpha male possessed that stare. We were evaluated, pondered, and ranked. And all while our lists of achievements and mob kills were also, no doubt, being scrutinized. Not even my passion for boxer shorts escaped the Ruard leader's keen eye. Players bustled about, doing the chief's bidding, and I couldn't keep a straight face. Kvalen, everything just as you suggested. Hunker down and keep a low profile. Eradani, a little less sarcasm. Play the simpleton. After you shouted at the top of your voice about a bunch of cranes and found the treasure? By the way, can you share the info? Later. No, now. I'm sick of playing blind. All I get is doublespeak and half-truths. Give me time to think of a plausible explanation for the Ruards. I sniggered again. Just for the Ruards? When they led us in convoy to the stairway, a portal opened close by, from which emerged two local guardians, preceded by their whiskers. A strange-looking, angular young man brought up the rear. Or girl. It was hard to be sure without a certain amount of hands-on investigation.
Tieflings Kvalen and Eradani, you are under arrest. Step into the portal.
A guy, after all. His speech was accompanied by a jerking of his Adam's apple, along to the chimes of Christmas bells, which created a certain dissonance, since what I witnessed didn't tally with the traditional white beard, red hat, and yo-ho-ho. As far as I was concerned, only Santa could jingle like that.
Messenger, a creature without level. Description, hidden. Abilities, hidden.
What are we accused of?
I fixed my gaze on the painstakingly mascaraed eyes of the black and curly-haired Cupidon. He fingered a precious stone that served as a button on his doublet, pursed his made-up lips, and waved a careless hand at the guardians.
You'll find out when we get there.
A shove in the back made me take a step straight into the glimmering ring. When we get there, it is, then. They probably wouldn't roll out the red carpet for us at Varduna's castle, either.
Teleport to the city of Velkor, capital of the province of Utmar.
Chapter 2.
I hadn't come across many paladins in my brief gaming career. I saw a couple when my character was being born. One saved me from Irenus's clutches, and Anastaria's pearly smile sparkled on the covers of all the glossies. There you have it. That's all the paladins I know. However, as soon as I clapped eyes on Governor Valtarosa, I knew I was in the presence of a true paladin, without even looking at his properties. His golden armor did not conceal, but rather it emphasized, his mighty warrior's figure. The chiseled, square, noble face, the eagle eyes, the strong jaw. The governor was a collage of hackneyed cliché. The only blemish was the modest, yet jolly, tuft of fair hair adorning his head. If my literature teacher had asked me to describe this NPC, he would have grimaced long and hard as he read my work, before shaming me in front of the class for overuse of cliché. To this, I would have retorted fervently that the fidelity of the image is more important than the rules. What could I do if the governor really was a walking cliché, outside and inside? I didn't have a clue about game design and development, but deep down I was sure this was no way to work. By looks of the governor, I would suppose he was a fleeting character rather than a ruler of five provinces.
I have sworn an oath to root out evil spirits, whatever form they may take. There is no place for them in Utmar. They must be expelled, and that's that. Let them make themselves scarce.
With his very first utterance, the paladin demonstrated his disdain for compromise. His voice, as was to be expected, was thoroughly consistent with his appearance, low and very masculine. Another 2 shillings into the cliché piggy bank.
The tieflings are guilty. You're right there, confirmed the unisex messenger, affectedly pouring himself some water from a carafe. But, my lord, we cannot expel them. It would show you in a bad light, and may reflect badly on your reputation. You know you'll never live that down. Let them pay for their crime first.
Our crime, as it turns out, was our last exchange with Ironess. To be more precise, there was nothing wrong with the exchange itself, but we should not have given her the glaive of Seth. The leaders of the Light of Barliona faction noticed the appearance of a new enemy and wanted to punish the guilty party, which meant me. The discussion dragged on, the governor arguing with the messenger about the seriousness of our crime and completely ignoring my attempts to exonerate us. I admit it wasn't so difficult, considering that several debuffs had robbed us of the ability to move and speak. I couldn't take in the surroundings at my own pace, which I so wanted to. It's not every day you find yourself in the reception room of such an influential NPC. Eradani. It isn't so bad. 4 months of corrective labor maximum. Mining or lumber milling. Then you get your reputation back. Don't agree to expulsion. I thought about it. It'll be worse. Kvalen. It couldn't be worse. I don't have 4 months. I have a deadline and criteria. Hogwash. Brody, you disappoint me. You're wasting time trying to fulfill criteria. Why work in reality when the game supplies all your needs? I don't understand you. And you won't understand me. You can't get out of here and I can. That's not the point. I used to practically live in Barliona. And what did that get you? Pretend battles, variable scripts, and digital pickup sticks? Everything's make-believe. But the money's real. And what's the difference anyway? Reality has the same battles, scripts, and pickup sticks. They just have a different backdrop. You're deluding yourself, and you don't understand that. I was quiet, not wanting to continue the argument. But my usually tactful partner wouldn't let it go. You have to understand, your work distractions only get in the way. You spend 6 hours a day on pointless shit instead of leveling up. Nobody's asking you to live in Barliona. Work hard here, live and play there. Get married, have kids, visit your parents. Victor, shut up. Stop trying to brainwash me. I'll work it out myself. We couldn't continue our squabble, since the debuffs had worn off and the messenger and the governor wanted to pronounce a sentence. Tieflings Kvalen and Eradani, your crime warrants the very severest punishment. For you, free men, this means banishment to the free lands for a minimum of 1 year. However, the Empire is merciful. You are being given the chance to work off your debt. The place of your labor will be selected randomly. 8 hours a day for 120 days, and you will be fully absolved. The governor is inclined to banish you, but I have insisted on labor. Work hard and earn the right to remain here. In regard to the transfer of the glaive of Seth to the NPC Ironess, you are offered the choice of 2 options. 1 year's exile, or 4 months' labor. Inflamed by the row, I read and reread the message, becoming all the more wound up. What should I choose? Neither option was any good for me. What freaking socialization if I'm in exile or the mines? It would be a fiasco for my criteria, and I'd lose my job. Screw Barliona and all its convolutions. I got by without it for 36 years. My partner chuckled to see my torment, but remained silent, leaving me to make my own decision.
A random selection timer appeared before my eyes, gingering up my already racing thoughts. 5 minutes. Either I choose for myself, or the system chooses for me. To hell with you and your conditions. I don't agree. With what? The messenger frowned and exchanged glances with the governor. I should be rewarded, not punished.
That's what I just said.
The reddening paladin brought his fist down on the table, his tuft nodding along with the strike.
Give them an inch, and they'll take the whole province. Banish them.
I demand the right to explain, I said, avoiding the word justify. I'd done nothing that required justification.
We can always banish them later, my lord, said the messenger amicably.
He'd noticed my steady gaze on him, awaiting his permission to have my say.
Let us first listen.
Great, I exhaled, joyful and smiling. I was now faced with the hardest of tasks, organizing my speech correctly. Merciful lords, I came here reckoning on acknowledgement, a reward, and bonuses for the clan. That is no joke. I must confess that the advantages to the Empire of Irenus powering up are obvious.
Just listen to this bullshit, roared the governor. So all of Barliona went blind and stupid when you showed up?
No, no, Your Grace. It's just such a difficult situation that the worthy heroes of Barliona may not have thought about it. I shall explain in just a second. Tell me, in what way is Irenus dangerous right now? She is far away and not attacking the Empire. Is that good?
Yes, it is.
She is somewhere, and that's fine. She existed before, and it didn't worry anybody. Although we do know the demon's attitude to Seth and his cult. They will do anything to destroy it. They need our world in its entirety, and they won't want to share it with Seth. What does that mean? It means the demon's main forces will now be transferred to the battle with Irenus. Look at the intelligence data. Skirmishes have died down. Demons are withdrawing deep into their own territories. The Empire's troops can rest, level up, get ready. When the demons are done with Irenus, we shall become only stronger, and they will incur losses. What are we guilty of? Fighting off Irenus and demons, and essentially gifting the Empire victory? Of course, I was relying on guesswork and my own conclusions, but it was a fine attempt. Silently, I applauded myself.
How did you get access to intelligence?
Frowned the irrepressible governor.
Are you spying on us?
I fancy his spies are logic and common sense.
The messenger was suddenly on my side.
Kvalen is both right and not right simultaneously. It has indeed become calmer at the border, but a new threat has appeared. One of Irenus's generals occupied the Tower of Thunder precisely 3 hours ago, while the cult of Seth was regenerating in Barliona. What it might mean, we don't yet know. It may not be victory at all, just the calm before the storm. So give me the opportunity to help. What's the point of me wasting time in exile or labor? In those 4 months, I'll send Irenus's general back to the abyss.
A third possibility had presented itself, and I was completely cool with it.
Too long.
The paladin looked me up and down. A month, not a day more. The Tower of Thunder is just 50 kilometers from the border with the Empire. That's not the kind of neighborhood we need. If you want to remain on Stivala, destroy it within the month.
That's impossible. Let's be realistic. Do you see my level? I evaded a level 80 demon throughout your entire basement, and you're talking about a general.
You still ran, noted the messenger, inspecting his nails. You escape, you run down an enemy, and maybe he dies from exhaustion.
That's settled then, declared the paladin, closing the court hearing. If, within 1 month from today, you have not destroyed Irenaeus's general, who is presently occupying the Tower of Thunder, you will be banished from Stivala for 1 year. That is my decision. Messenger, confirm it.
You still have the opportunity to do labor for 4 months, said the youth, and the updated description lit up before my eyes. In regard to the transfer of the glaive of Seth to the NPC Irenaeus, you are offered the choice of two options. Destroy General Advar, who is occupying the Tower of Thunder, deadline for completion 1 month from today. If you fail, you will be banished from the continent of Stivala for 1 year. Or do 4 months' labor.
I agree to destroy the general, I confirmed, and Eradani facepalmed. A countdown timer appeared in the top right corner. 29 days, 23 hours, 59 minutes. Exactly how long I had left to live on Stivala.
Upgrades gained. +1 to charisma. +1 to luck. New characteristic available. Eloquence. Description. You are eloquent. Your ability to engross NPCs in conversation, from 1 to 100 creatures simultaneously, and curry favor, is impressive. Each characteristic point increases your ability to engross an interlocutor or crowd and put them to sleep for 20 minutes by 0.1% right up to 50%. Integrates with charisma.
Send them back,
the governor requested of the messenger, and strode off. The audience was over.
Portal to Lokdar.
The ill-tempered messenger waved a hand, creating a glimmering circle. Eradani stepped right through without waiting for me. I hesitated and looked at the youth, who was now standing by me. I could easily imagine him as an artist, a designer, or a life model, but not a representative of a higher power. Although in truth, what did I know about them? Noticing my interest in him, the messenger questioningly raised a painted eyebrow. In my head arose a question. What if... So first, he must have a delicate psyche, amenable to flattery.
Your Grace, I would like to thank you. You have done much for me. You defended me in front of the governor, insisted on labor, allowed me to justify myself.
The messenger viewed me askance, but the natural ruddiness of his cheeks confirmed that my praise had achieved its purpose. Now to use the opportunity. Might I offer a gift as a sign of my gratitude?
Are you offering me a bribe?
The youth darkened and began to grow until he hung threateningly over me. I had to pick up the pace. Since the boss's death, a dark crystal containing the essence of the incubus had lain in my inventory, and I now hastened to offer it to the messenger.
It's not a bribe, it's a modest gift from the leader of a modest clan.
Gift, exhaled the youth, enchanted, and the surrounding space began to reel. Beneath our feet opened a portal which threw us right into a thicket of coniferous trees. A dark fog on the map indicated that cartographer had no idea where we were and was giving up. Shrinking back to his regular size, the messenger tried to take the crystal from me, but as I hadn't yet given my consent to the transfer, his hands passed through the object. They were simply in different dimensions. A second attempt followed, and a bout of unintelligible cussing in an unfamiliar language, before the messenger extended a demanding hand.
Show me, and I shall decide whether or not to accept your gratitude.
The youth's fingers were trembling lightly. He was more like a junkie meeting his dealer than an emperor's representative. I handed him the crystal, and he stroked it like a kitten. His look glazed over, and he began to mutter, barely discernibly. A level 80 incubus, fully subjugated. What a gift. You are, my precious.
Ahem. A delicate cough reminded him of my presence.
Yes. The messenger tore himself away from the crystal. You said it was a gift, non-reciprocal.
Absolutely correct. A modest gift from a modest clan.
Yes, modest indeed.
Contradictory to his evaluation, the messenger continued to fondle the crystal.
And you understand you get nothing in return?
I do not wish for anything, apart from to know where I am. I looked around, but except for the woods, I could see nothing.
Somewhere in the borderlands of the province of Lokdar,
shrugged the youth.
You'll have to find yourself by yourself.
Map updated. Description of changes. You have received a fragment of a map of the province of Lokdar. Familiarity with current location, 70%.
I opened the map and struggled to keep my mouth shut. A vast province stretched before me, nearly 300 kilometers wide and 200 long. The Empire's western border was a full-flowing river, and beyond it, the lands of the demons burned red. Somewhere out there stood the Tower of Thunder. To the south, the province was bathed by the Southern Ocean, with its scattered profusion of islands large and small. In the southeast, and farther to the east, rose mountains, and only in the north were forests to be found, and the next province visible.
It's time for you to return.
The youth cast a scrupulous eye over the forest, snapped his fingers, and we were in the center of a perfect forest glade. There, he conjured up another portal for me.
I shall remember your non-reciprocal gift, Tiefling Kvalen. By way of reciprocal goodwill, I shall tell you my name, Marcel. Remember it.
I bowed and entered the portal. Before the snow-white vortex span me into its crazy dance, I managed to catch the low bass of the embodied incubus.
Your wish is my command.
That's the higher echelons of power for you.
The eponymous capital of the province of Lokdar greeted me with the buzz of a wasp's nest. The local task had been replaced with a new one, urban renewal. Everywhere, saws squeaked, hammers knocked, steel rang, and sharp words were voiced, as players industriously boosted their levels and reputations. I didn't care for all the racket. I'd never been drawn to manual labor, and wasn't much up for new acquaintance. Tranquilizers pepped me up, though it was already 3 a.m., and I would have to be up for work in 4 hours. I had things other than rebuilding to think about.
Eradani, where are you? It's time to choose a site for the castle.
Kvalen, I'm done for the day. Back tomorrow.
If I'm honest, I could have busied myself some more, but my vexation with Eradani hadn't passed. Walking to the nearest hotel, I paid for 24 hours security and pressed the exit button. The lid of the pod slid aside, releasing me to freedom. I crawled to the bathroom and spent some time contrast showering Barliona out of my system. It was only upon detailed inspection of my body in the mirror that my brain clocked the disappearance of my tail and horns. What a sorry sight. Maddie was right. A month in the game, and I looked not so much pinched as deflated or burst, like Eeyore's balloon. My skin hung in ugly waves, like I was being fitted for a suit several sizes too big. It occurred to me I ought to cancel tomorrow's girls. It was one thing to saddle an elastic wave, but quite another to do it on a semi-flat mattress. Yuck, what a gross thought. I wasn't tired at all. I checked in on Maddie, noted his pod working, and plodded back to my room. The image in the mirror wouldn't leave me alone. How much weight had I lost? 20? 30 pounds? My health concerned me. Leaps like that could cost me dearly. There's your super pod for you. Not a single problem notification. I opened the fitness module records, and my heart skipped a beat. If the stats were to be believed, I'd lost 52 pounds in almost 4 weeks. No way! After quickly rooting out my ex-wife's scales from the closet, I double-checked. No mistake. My hand reached for the telephone to call for an ambulance. I had tried to lose weight many times, most often getting as far as reading up on the latest method or theory. You could say I was a professional weight loss theorist. And like any professional, I knew that a man could lose up to 6 kilograms a month with no physical consequences. And for beginners, particularly of my constitution, that figure could double. That's 12, maximum 15 kilograms, but nowhere near 24. The medics arrived 3 minutes later. Of course, my family doctor was asleep, so the imitator found me a physician from another time zone. By the time the mawkish smile of Dr. John Mello from Calgary appeared on the screen, my fresh test results were already on his desktop. Brody, our conversation is being recorded and will be made available to your local doctor, along with the test results. What seems to be the problem? I was lost. When I called the imitator, I clearly stated I suspected it was an emergency. And this walking toothpaste ad was grinning like nothing had happened. Doctor, I've lost almost 30 kilograms in a month. That's the problem. Ah, I see the problem. I'll send you a prescription for some sedative tablets. I don't need sedatives, I sputtered, exasperated, wondering where they found these idiots. Dr. Mello, are my test results in order? Yes, absolutely. The Canadian smiled his confirmation. But I've lost 24 kilograms. Brody, surely you didn't think you would recover fully in a month. Considering your age, height, and metabolic disorder, you were absolutely right to switch the pod to rehabilitation mode. Yes, you would have gotten better results on full, but at what price? It would have been hard on your body. So you don't think anything critical is happening? This kind of weight loss is perfectly safe? Oh, I see what you mean. The already broad smile broadened further. You think you've lost too much, right? After hearing the doctor out and dismissing the medbot imitator, I chewed over what I'd heard. I was as bad a theorist as I was a practitioner. This time I screwed up on data collection. According to the doctor, my professional pod checked my metabolism, analyzed the readings, and sent the results to my local GP every hour. My point was that he hadn't shown his face for a month, when he used to demand blood all the time. Now the pod did everything. And so well that for the first time in 10 years, not one of my blood bio readings was outside the permissible limits. I was essentially as strong as an ox. But a problem really was looming, and the pod wouldn't cope with it. Active fat burning and redevelopment of my muscles had resulted in sagging folds of skin. With each month, I looked more like the Michelin Man, and Dr. Smartass was categorical here. There was no way to return the skin to its original condition. If I wanted to remove the repulsive folds, I would have to go under the knife, but not for another 3 months. It was a great weight off of my mind to know I wasn't dying. 4 a.m., and I still wasn't tired. Thanks to Dr. Mello and the pod with its bracing injections. After a couple of cups of coffee alone, I decided the only sensible thing was to go to work. The roads were empty. I'd make it in half an hour. What did it matter where I killed my time? I wasn't going back to Barliona. The door winked a green light at me and opened. The building was filled with a deafening silence, cut with the gentle hum of the air conditioning. The morning sun peeped through the partially shut blinds, and reluctantly I smiled. It was all right. I was alive and well, nearly young, and soon to be beautified. The day promised to be sunny, but not hot. Snapping my fingers in time to the music in my head, I went to the conference hall. Brody, what are you doing here? The boss's secretary gawked at me from the doors to the lift area.
I couldn't sleep, so I decided to do some work. What about you? Do you live here?
My question was entirely serious. No, she smiled, accepting my explanation. I'm here on a personal matter.
At work? A personal matter? At 5 in the morning?
Yes, although I admit it does sound strange. Victoria smiled again, then checked herself. You know, it's actually a good thing you're here.
Really?
Seeing her enthusiasm, I began to rue my presence. Yes, Brody, you're a man, right?
There was definitely a trap around the bend. That question had never yet boded well for a man. Last time I looked, it was a silly joke, but simply to confirm her suspicion would have been trite.
Excellent. Then you'll have no problem carrying a box to my car. I was going to call a transport imitator, but you know how long they take. And we don't have them in the office. She knew very well I couldn't refuse her after that. It would be awkward, and contrary to my upbringing. I hated women being manipulative, especially if they did it so primitively. Never mind. Let's see this box, then. As befitted a hero, I proudly approached the enormous box, which stood on the floor in the foyer, and lifted it. Then I very unheroically grunted. What on earth did she have in here? Victoria regarded me quizzically, expecting me to ask for assistance, but I refrained. Don't hold your breath, viper lady. Professional pods rule. I have muscles now. With a quiet, Victoria scooped up her bag and strode confidently toward the lifts, while the box staggered wheezing and puffing after her.
Have you got a body in here?
Traveling in silence in the lift was hard, psychologically and physically. I was forced to recommence the conversation. What? Victoria was miles away and didn't immediately understand the question. No, just parts. Well done. Calmly answered. Casual, even. Brody, be careful with your expensive shoes. If blood leaks out, it'll ruin them.
So, you're in on it after all. I grunted, in the hope it was her strange sense of humor.
Even so, what was she doing in the office so early? Don't worry. If we get caught, my family will make sure you get a regular jail cell instead of a pod. I know how much you like virtuality.
You're too kind.
The lift stopped on the parking level, and we walked past rows of empty spaces.
Could they put us in a cell together, by way of compensation?
That's out of the question. I'll get let off. I'm an only child.
I see, I croaked, hoisting the load into the trunk of a very expensive, latest model, exclusive series monster of a car, before the rear door closed smoothly.
Why, oh, why would such a fragile slip of a woman need such a speedy beast as this? It was a gift I couldn't refuse. It's considered the safest car on the roads today, explained Victoria, sliding in.
I didn't say a word.
Damn, my fingerprints were on the box. You made such a face, I thought it best to explain.
You were standing behind me, I countered.
My, Brody, this joke about complicities made you really slow-witted.
Victoria continued the conversation through the opened window.
Tinted windows, just like a mirror. I saw your reflection.
Victoria, they don't by any chance call you the all-seeing eye because of your eyes, do they?
Her perceptiveness and involvement in everything going on in the company were really annoying. They call me all sorts of things because of my eyes, she replied, unruffled. While I was contemplating what to say next, Victoria activated the autopilot. She might at least have said thank you. It wasn't so much offensive as awkward. I was turning to leave when she called my name.
Brody, where are you going? I didn't thank you for your help.
So thank me, and I'll be off, I shrugged. The door on the opposite side of the car opened.
Hop in. Work doesn't start for another 3 hours. Breakfast's on me.
I hesitated for show before getting in. Victoria inquired about my preferred choice of cuisine, entered the address into the GPS, and we pulled out into the emergency lane. Secretaries don't live half badly these days.
Thanks for your help. You're a good man. I thought you'd refuse.
I wanted to, more than once. So what's in the box? Definitely not a body? Only in an allegorical sense. Victoria laughed.
It's part of a bronze statue, an antique. That's why I came in early. They promised to deliver it by lunchtime yesterday, but the plane was delayed, and it only came in the evening, when I was already at home. They refused to change the delivery address.
Are you a collector?
Not me, my grandfather. So how can I thank you?
Well, since we're going for breakfast now, how about you buy me dinner? I was joking, and I was sure she'd refuse anyway, but just to quash any doubt, I hastily added, "But I must warn you, I eat a lot."
I actually thought you'd stopped eating since you joined the company.
If you don't take me on, I'll stop drinking as well, I promised.
Okay, dinner it is, but not today, Victoria agreed, but not overly enthusiastically.
It all felt a bit silly. For some reason I'd suggested, and for some reason she'd agreed, when we weren't particularly attracted to each other.
By the way, in 2 weeks, there's an informal corporate event out of town.
And what does that mean?
Nothing in particular. Mr. Williams sometimes organizes a picnic or something for the staff, with an entertainment program.
Is attendance mandatory? The prospect of going somewhere and pretending to be interested in eating with strangers didn't inspire me.
For you, yes, she emphasized, pulling into an empty parking lot.
All sensible people were still asleep.
Chapter 3. Hey, I don't get it. Where's my 15-course lunch?
I arrived home from work to a kitchen sparkling with sterility and emptiness.
A month ago, it would not have surprised me, but now, unable to see Maddie, I felt mildly annoyed.
After the turmoil of the night, my body was demanding at least a mammoth, and Victoria's light breakfast snack had merely whet my appetite.
Maddie's door closed, and he entered the kitchen, yawning widely.
What's all this shouting about?
Didn't you cook today?
No, I was on a raid. Choose something from the robo-cook, he said, waving me away.
My mild annoyance was replaced by umbrage.
You could have cooked something nice. I finished the nursery yesterday, for your information.
You could have warned me.
What's with the attitude?
Maddie was a bit rattled.
I thought you didn't like my cooking.
I like it. Your cooking's okay. I sighed and understood the funny side of the situation.
Wow, sorry. I'm so used to you greeting me after work and feeding me, I'd begun to take it for granted.
Yes, Maddie nodded, choosing a program on the robo-cook.
It's easy to get used to the easy life. So what about the nursery?
Tasty food is an underrated weapon. Eat your fill, and half the battle's won. You wish nobody any harm. You don't want to attack anybody.
Come to think of it, you're not really that bothered about moving at all.
Hold on a sec, I'm going to have a nap.
It's a control mechanism to suit everyone.
If only we knew where to find enough tasty food to pacify all the ambitious, the angry, and the hungry.
Sated and mellowed, we lay back to discuss plans.
So I head over your way. Matty yawned again and scratched his belly. No hurry. There's nowhere to head yet. We've created the clan, and Eridani and I are going to choose a site for the castle today. I can help you. How? I've already got more than enough problems, what with deadlines and criteria. By the way, how's that unique task going? It's going great. Helen's team have really helped me level up. I don't know how to thank you for her. My friend's face was so gleeful, I wondered what exactly he was thanking me for. Finish the task, then you can thank me. I have to pour a whole load more money into you. Eridani won't like it if we don't see results. Eridani this, Eridani that, Matty muttered before sitting up suddenly. Brody, what's going on? I opened one eye. When he was rubbing shoulders with you in the nursery, I kept mum, I understood. But taking him into our clan on the continent, why? I didn't like his emphasis on our, and was wide awake in no time. I don't get it, Matty. What's your problem with him? What do you know about him? Nothing. He spread his arms in bewilderment. Great advisor. Are you sure he won't betray us? I'm not. What's he doing time for? And what's with the conditions? Tell nothing to anyone. Very convenient. I wouldn't refuse either. He clung onto you like a leech. What does he want? The worst thing was that Matty's questions were absolutely justified, but there was no need to admit it. That's what we do know. He needs someone tried and tested, someone he can trust and rely on. Yesterday he was insisting I quit work in reality to concentrate fully on the game. I don't like it. Matty's voice was drier than a herbarium. What about you? Me? I was thinking about Victoria. If there was no way to find out there and then about his crime, everything we knew about Mr. X would require systematizing. Elderly, married, or was, children, educated, ambitious, a certain amount of power and wealth. That's no use at all. Nothing to do with anything. Ah, here we are. Master's degree from Rivaldo's dance school. Not too many of them around. So what do you think? Persisted Matty. I mean, about work. My mind still on Victoria, I told it as it was. I have no idea. It's a strange company. In a month, I haven't figured out what they do. I'm just some poor gopher. Get lost. Don't interrupt. With my experience? The director appears to have senile dementia. That secretary has her nose in everything. Ridiculous criteria. Today I get to work. It's not even 5 o'clock, and the secretary's dragging a huge box out of the office. Right. You get to work at 5 in the morning, and they're strange? I think you fit in there. However hard my friend tried to seem relaxed, his jittery leg gave him away. What? Work in reality first and foremost. Got it? Do we have a plan? Yes, we do. So, we stick to it. What about Eridani? Matty said, pulling a face. His ill feeling toward the clan advisor was only growing. Forget about him. I wasn't born yesterday either. His business is to advise, and my business is to accept or reject advice. We can always get rid of him later. First, we complete the task to find the island. I'm interested. Matty looked untrusting daggers at me. Don't panic. Run around with Helen for another 2 weeks. I have a month to kill the general. If I don't, I get exiled. You can't go with me. I maintained a discreet silence concerning the fact that I wouldn't be able to fulfill my criteria in exile. Agreed. But I'm coming with you after the general. We'll see how you behave, I muttered, realizing I didn't have the strength to fight off sleep. It seemed somebody switched off the lights and sound. I returned to Barliona 2 hours later, after a good, deep sleep, my head cleared, and my muscles feeling a natural, as opposed to a medicinal, energy. Eradani was in the same hotel I'd stayed at the day before. He was sitting at a table downstairs and picking lazily at his plate. You didn't have to be psychic to see he was waiting. Apart from him, the bar was empty. I approached the bar and knocked to attract the owner's attention. The fat innkeeper, his apron and hair equally greasy, tore himself away from his book, glanced at me, frowned, and returned nonchalantly to his reading. "Excuse me," I exclaimed, knocking perseveringly as if to hint that I wasn't going anywhere. The big man raised his eyes again before lumbering to his feet, tucking his book under his arm, and stamping over to me, the glasses on the bar jumping in time to his footfall. "The Beer Baron, From Tavern to Lord of the World," I read the title of the book. Bizarre.
"What do you want?"
squeaked the potential Lord of the World. My agreeability to him was only 15, which was 5 below standard. "Good day. I see you're reading an interesting book." My attempt to boost my agreeability failed. Musclehead's eyebrows knitted even further, and he repeated his question.
"What do you want?"
I gave up. Breakfast, and to extend my stay. Instead of a reply, the barkeep slammed a "no vacancies" sign down on the bar and squinted unfavorably at my horns. If this were to continue, it was going to be hard to win back the tiefling. "What about food?" I forced a smile.
"Okay,"
he replied with aversion and nodded toward Eradani.
"Eat up fast and get out of here with your buddy. Don't frighten my customers off."
I nodded meekly and joined my partner. We clearly wouldn't be getting any quests out of this bibliophile. As I approached, Eradani pushed aside his plate and reached for his beer. "The Ruard question is sorted. They won't be bothering us." Taking a couple of swigs, he gave me time to appreciate what a good boy he was. I nodded, half in greeting, half in acknowledgement of the information, and took a seat.
"You were asking who the cranes were."
"I already know. Hirelings without clan affiliation. They work for the Celestials, carry out special assignments. That's why they're clanless. So the actions of one don't affect the reputation of the rest."
"Did I leave anything out?"
"No." "Why did you think she's a crane?"
"That's classified information, but I was right."
The old man's eyes radiated smugness. "We've already contacted Vardunas and bailed Varmilda." "How does that threaten us? Is she going to wreak her revenge?"
"I don't think so. The cranes are here on reconnaissance. They're looking for something. They don't need the unnecessary attention."
"Is that why she killed the boss right under Varduna's nose?" The skeptic in me awoke. "And then popped up in the general chat and waited for Ruard to come and sort it out? Yeah, right."
"Don't sneer. That's just details. We know Varmilda went crawling to Ruard herself, but that doesn't concern us, right? Let's just assume she was banking on an epic garment from the boss."
A lame old woman served my breakfast, clattering the plate on the table and forcing a lull in our conversation.
"How much time have you got at the weekend? How much can I reckon on?"
Eradani asked. I understood my sortie into reality the previous day had ruffled his feathers. "How much can I reckon on?" I aped him in my head. "Good question. Well, today's Friday. I'm all yours until Sunday evening."
"Excellent," he said, and wiped his mouth thoughtfully.
"There are 10 provinces on Stivala, and ours is the smallest. The province of Lokdar is in the south, the spot most remote from the main battalions, and the least popular. Ideal for a castle. I can sketch a map in 2 weeks, then we'll choose a site." I've already sketched it. It was nice to get one over on the experienced and resourceful player. Sending him Marcel's map, I couldn't resist having a dig. Don't ask where I got it. It's classified information. Eradani squinted to inspect the picture only he could see. Who did you manage to sell your soul to? He blinked and regarded me with interest. You guessed it, just not my own, unlike some. I was testing the water in the hope of an honest conversation. It didn't happen. Eradani didn't react in the least, didn't hide his eyes, and didn't take them from mine, bombarding me with highly disgruntled vibes. Steadily, I batted them back. He cracked first and materialized the map on the table. Here. He prodded a finger in the very south, at the point where the Green River flowed into the Southern Ocean, separating the Empire from the lands of the demons. Forest, ore, sea, 150 kilometers to Lokdar. Ideal for a castle. Plus, with all the demons, pirates, crank players, and lack of a portal, ain't no way we dragon folk out to these boondocks. As you can see, I'm not stupid either. I really didn't like the place Eradani was suggesting, and I prepared to argue my case, as did he. The door opened with an unpleasant groan, denying us both a sneaky head start. We both looked around to see someone vaguely familiar enter.
Hey, barkeep! Beer for me and my friends!
Looking closer, I recognized Master Bartolin, a student of Boar Goldenhand, a dwarf we had saved from oblivion and demons. He waved to us. He looked almost well, despite having gone bald. He walked assuredly to our table, pulled up a stool, clambered onto it, and cursed violently when his head barely showed above the table. Even the warhammer he placed under his butt didn't save the day.
"So where's my beer?"
he bawled, hanging his weighty nose over the table. It looked like he was sniffing it. In a trice, the barkeep lay his book aside and leaped into action. The same hobbling crone brought us three dark beers, wiping the table before she put them down.
"2-hour meeting."
Without waiting for support, the dwarf drained his 3-pint mug and demanded a refill. When he reached the bottom of his third, he let rip a mighty burp before reclining against the back of the chair, which turned out not to be there. Predictably, he fell, his bald head hitting the deck and splitting the rotten floorboards in two. Nobody stirred. Kvalen. Is this a quest chain? What's it doing here? Eradani. Could be. We'll see.
Ah, you motherfucker!
The irate master jumped to his feet, seized the two nearest stools and a neighboring table, and before anyone could blink, was lost in a cloud of busyness. The hall was filled with dull thumps, the buzzing of a saw, and the smell of freshly worked wood. When the dust settled, the beaming Bartolin was perched atop a wooden throne, and a perfect throne at that. The back, the padded seat on the hard apron, the carved armrests, and the interesting properties. Throne of Master Bartolin. Description: a unique object with no category. Any dwarf who sits on the throne will receive a buff, the blessing of Master Bartolin. +10 to all characteristics and inebriety for 1 hour. The object is bound to the Unicorn of Dreams pub.
That's better.
An intoxicated smile spread over the dwarf's face.
Bartender, a year's worth of free drinks for me and my tiefling friends.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.